In 2002, American Electric Power bought an entire village of 221 residents in southeastern Ohio. It was seemingly the first time in history a corporate buyout of this magnitude had occurred. Today we're going to find out how it all happened and visit the company town in its current state. Cheshire is a small village located on the Ohio River in northeastern Gallia County, Ohio. It was founded around 1850 when its existence started being marked on old maps. It had relatively flat farmland near the Ohio River and was located in an area rich with coal, so mining was very profitable until the mid-1900s. During that time, the town endured several devastating floods, but was able to recover and life moved on. In 1954, the Kiger Creek Power Plant, owned by the Ohio Valley Electric Company, was built 2 miles south of the village, bringing jobs and stimulating the shaky economy. Kiger Creek then incorporated Cheshire so they could qualify for county funding, which they used to improve the overall standard of living. Then, a couple decades later, American Electric Power came to town and they had some big plans. The James N. Gavin coal-fired supercritical power plant was constructed in 1975 near the town of Cheshire in Gallia County along the Ohio River. It's the largest power plant in Ohio and the 19th largest in the United States with a capacity of 2.6 gigawatts. It produces more than 11% of Ohio's power and can light 2 million homes. Burning coal at large magnitudes can create several toxic gases that can negatively impact human health and the environment. Sulfur dioxide is the main contributor to acid rain and is the main pollutant produced from burning coal. Nitrogen oxide contributes to smog, ozone, and respiratory diseases, while small particulate matter aggravates asthma and can cause chronic bronchitis. Carbon monoxide starves cells of oxygen in high doses, and heavy metals such as lead and cadmium are toxic for the environment. And of course, the most talked about pollutant is carbon dioxide, which contributes to the greenhouse gas effect and eventually global warming. So, in order for a coal power plant to be in compliance with the Clean Air Act, several measures must be in place. Selective catalytic reduction systems convert nitrogen oxides into diatomic nitrogen and water and are used in industrial applications from car engines to power plants. To filter out small particulate matter and dust, the exhaust is sometimes blown through cylindrical porous bags, which capture the dust before it's released into the air. Electrostatic precipitators are also used, which ionize small particulate matter, which then gets collected on a grounding plate. Scrubbers made of limestone and water are also very effective at removing small particulate matter and sulfur dioxide from exhaust gas. However, the scrubbers themselves are massive and often use up to 2% of the power generated by the reactor just to operate. In the 1980s, local environmentalists were taking notice to the amount of sulfur dioxide being emitted from the plant. In 1984, Rob Inheed, along with several other Greenpeace activists, parachuted from the top of the 1,300-foot smokestack to raise awareness for the negative environmental impact. AEP then tore down the single smokestack and replaced it with two 800-foot stacks to prevent the launching of particles into the atmosphere, but this just made pollution more of an issue at the surface. Facing several potential lawsuits after the Clean Air Act was amended in 1994, AEP installed several scrubbers at the plant to reduce the sulfur dioxide emissions by about 90%. But they made the problem worse. The villagers complained of fly ash falling out of the sky onto their vehicles. In 1998, AEP tried again and installed low NOx burners, which reduced the concentration of nitrogen oxides in the exhaust gas. In 2001, AEP installed a selective catalytic reduction system to convert the remaining nitrogen oxides to nitrogen and water, thereby fully cleaning any waste emitted by the plant. But once again, it didn't work. The SCR system released sulfur trioxide, which blanketed the town in a blue smog in the humid summer of 2001. The residents of Cheshire were fed up by the fall and hired a private law firm to take legal action against AEP. But unlike Centralia, where it took 20 years and a 12-year-old sliding down a mine shaft for the state to take action, AEP decided to buy the town in April of 2002. It was a smart move on their part, and most likely the cheapest for the corporation, and the residents got a pretty good deal on paper. For those wanting to leave, AEP would give them more than 3 times the value of their home, which probably wouldn't have sold anyway, in exchange for a contractual waiving of the right to sue AEP for any health problems they might encounter in the future. From a meteorological standpoint, Cheshire is located to the north of the Gavin plant, which means southerly flow is what blows the pollutants towards the town. This is more likely to happen in the summer, and due to the humid climate and abundant sunshine, toxic smog can develop often. It's impossible to tell whether the residents or former residents are going to develop severe health issues from living by the plant. In the case of Centralia, carbon monoxide detectors showing high levels of the gas showed that the danger was very real. In the case of Three Mile Island and Chernobyl, high levels of nuclear radiation have been proven to cause cancer and many other abnormalities. But in this case, it's very unclear. AEP worked incredibly quickly on the $20 million deal, and by late 2003, most of the town was empty and then bulldozed. Today, only about 100 people remain in the town, which was annexed to include more residents in outlying areas. They stayed by choice. The main thing I noticed when visiting, besides the giant looming cooling towers and billowing steam, is the constant loud hum of the power plant. Take a listen. I associate Southern Ohio with the peace and quiet in the summer, and the loud hum is extremely unsettling and a constant reminder that you're on company land. I'll leave you with some footage from my visit. And if you're enjoying this, be sure to like and subscribe and share with other people that might be interested. It really helps me out. You can also check out my Polaroid collection on Etsy. The link is in the description below, and every purchase helps fuel more videos. And as always, keep exploring.